اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين الذي علا في توحده ودنا في تفرده وجل في سلطانه وعظم في أركانه الذي لا يدركه بعد الهمم ولا يناله غوص الفتن. ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين الذي سمي في السماء بأحمد وفي الأراضين بأبي القاسم المصطفى محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد. طب القلوب ودوائها ونور أبصارها وعلى أهل بيته الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. صل على محمد وعلى محمد. بهم نتولى ومن أعدائهم نتبرع إلى يوم القيامة. عباد الله، أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله عز وجل. قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه الكريم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، هو الذي جعل لكم الأرض ذلولا فامشوا في مناكبها وكلوا من رزقه وإليه النشور. آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوات اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. First of all, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us this moment and this opportunity to observe our weekly Eid, which is Jumu'ah. I first admonish myself and each and every one of you, respected brothers and sisters, mu'mineen and mu'minat, to have the consciousness of the teachings of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which no doubt in numerous verses of Quran, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala highlighted on the importance of gaining consciousness. To such an extent, God admonishes us that we should not depart from this world until and unless we are able to submit wholeheartedly to His teachings and His command. The verse I've just quoted from glorious Quran is Quran 67 verse 15, that is Suratul Mulk. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala in this verse of Quran is telling us, huwa alladhi ja'ala lakum al-arda dhalula. He is the one who made for you this earth smooth. Then he said, famshu fi manaqibiha, walk about on this space of the earth. Then he said, وَكُلُوا مِنْ رِزْكِهِ وَإِلَيْهِ النَّشُورِ. Then as you walk around, you go around this earth, eat from the rizq of Allah. But as you eat from His rizq, do not forget that the return belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now departing from this verse of Suratul Mulk, my topic of discussion in the first sermon of today's Jumu'ah will be to look at ways and means of dealing with wealth. We're discussing this before I travel. You know for sure in life, there is one thing that insan is always overwhelmed with. That is wealth accumulation. Before coming to Juma, you were at work. After Juma, you will go back to work. There are those who are employed, and there are those who are employers. Most of the people you see outside on the road is nothing but wealth accumulation. Today, most of the fight that people have in the world is about power and wealth accumulation. Now, what I want to discuss today is, be it an employer or employee, self-employed, Now that you are able to accumulate the wealth, irrespective of the amount of the wealth, be it small or big, what does Islam say on the way of handling the wealth? You've gone out, you're getting something every month, or you are able to accumulate a good amount of money. How do we handle it from the teachings of Quran and the teachings of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam? Now we're going to do that in this first sermon in four ways. Number one, we're going to look at Islamic philosophy of wealth accumulation. What is the objective of working? What is the objective of making money? 80% of our life is about wealth accumulation. Even our boys and girls who go to school, what is the end product? The end aim is to make money, is to live good life. So first we'll look at the philosophical dimension of wealth accumulation from the teachings of Islam. And then number two, we'll look at the Islamic economical principles of wealth accumulation, because we have Islamic economics. Like though we have the world economics, we have Islamic economics. And each economical school has its own theory and principle. So we will look at Islamic, from the Islamic economical approach or dimension. What does it mean to accumulate wealth? And how do I relate to this wealth? And how do I handle this wealth? And thirdly, we'll look at the Islamic humanitarian side of wealth accumulation. You go to work, you work. But Islam doesn't want you to forget that irrespective of your position at work, you are a human being. Irrespective of who you are, you deal with human beings. The money you have doesn't change you to become someone else. You are still a human being. So from the Islamic humanitarian perspective, there is a lesson on the philosophy of wealth accumulation. And lastly, which we all know, is the jurisprudential teaching of wealth accumulation, which in the previous lesson, although it's been quite long, I discussed that, where I discussed about how important it is to go out and work. And you do not rely on someone. Don't become a beggar. Now first, let us look at the philosophy of wealth accumulation in Islam. Mantuqul falsafi, as they mentioned. You see, from the philosophical point of view, there are two things you have to bear in mind, brothers and sisters, as you go about your life, as you try to make money. Don't forget that. These two things defines people when they go out to make money. The first one, they said, ala nahwil mawdu'iyya, and the second one, ala nahwil tariqiyya. This is discussed in Principles of Jurisprudence. There are people, when they make money, they think that the money is the aim and the sole objective of life. And there are people, when they make money, they know that this money is not the aim and purpose of life, but it's a way or means to the aim and purpose of life. Now in Islam, the philosophy of wealth accumulation is that the wealth is not the aim. You have now accumulated the wealth, or you get your salary at the end of the month. Islam says that is not the aim. Islam says it's ala nahwi tariqiyya. It is means to the aim. Say at the end of the month you make 2,000 pounds. That's wealth accumulation. There are those who make 100 pounds every week. That is wealth accumulation. There are those who make 100,000 every year. That is wealth accumulation. Islamic philosophy of accumulating this wealth is that the wealth is not the aim. It is means to the aim. It is means to the objective. This is what scholars mention. We have what is called khattu sagir or khattu al-qasir and khattu tawil. We have a small thin line and we have a long big line. Don't make money by just looking at a small thin line. Make money by looking at a long thin line. What is a small thin line? Meaning I'm going to live this world 100 years. So I'm going to enjoy my life. I'm making my money because I want to enjoy. Because I am thinking that my aim is to make the money, and beyond making the money, there is nothing. But there is a long line. This long line is what? It is means to the aim. I make the money. Make your money. It's important to make money. But I know at the back of my mind, going to pharmacy to work and make the money, going on train to work and make the money, wherever I make my money, in building, in property, secondhand clothes, whatever, banking, I know it is not the aim. It is means to the aim. Now the question is, in Islamic philosophy, what is the aim of wealth accumulating? The aim is akhirah. The aim in Islam of wealth accumulation is akhirah. Meaning when I go to work and I make money, I'm making for the sake of akhirah. And that is what Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala in Quran 28 verse 77 tells us. وَابْتَغِ فِيمَا آتَاكَ اللَّهُ دَارَ الْآخِرَةِ وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, وَابْتَغِ فِيمَا آتَاكَ اللَّهُ دَارَ الْآخِرَةِ. Seek the house of akhirah from what we have given you. You make the money at work. Allah comes in and said, use that money to seek akhirah. Then Allah said, وَلَا تَنْسَ نَصِيبَكَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا. Do not forget your share of this dunya. Meaning go out, your share is there. Go and work. But the philosophy is what? The money is means to akhirah. That is why you have a very beautiful tradition from Imam Hassan al-Zaki, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. Imam said, "I'mal lidunyaka ka'annaka ta'ishu abada wa'mal li'akhiratika ka'annaka tamutu ghadan." Allahu Akbar. Imam said, work for your dunya as if you are going to live forever. Meaning go out, make money as if I am going to stay here permanently. But then he said, wa'mal li'akhiratika ka'annaka tamutu ghada, and work for your akhirah as if you are dying tomorrow. So the philosophy of wealth accumulation is what, brothers and sisters in Islam, is that let my wealth become a means for me to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let my work and my wealth become a means for me to improve upon my salah. Let my wealth become a means for me to become the most humble person. That is why, I don't know why if I mentioned this before here, Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen visited one of his companions. Salawat. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. By the name Asim ibn Ziyad. Asim had a very big house. Very big house. Like some of us, we have a big house. Allah has blessed us with big house. Which is excellent. There is nothing wrong with that in Islam to have mansions. When Amir al-Mu'mineen visited Asim, he asked him, Alhamdulillah, Allah has blessed you. You have a big house. Can you use this house to seek akhirah? Then Asim asked Amir al-Mu'mineen, how can I use this to seek akhirah? This is a place I live. Then Imam Amir mentioned three things. Said, number one, if your house become a place where you welcome guests and you provide them a place to stay, your house can become a means to akhirah. Number two, Imam said, if your house become a place where you strengthen family relations, silatul rahim, silay rahim, Today we have many people, they don't talk with their family members. Brothers are coming to the same mosque. He walk that door, that person walk another door. They come here during salawat, when he reaches brothers, he doesn't shake hands. There are people like that in our community. Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam spoke to his beloved companion, if you want your house to become a means to akhirah, then use that house to strengthen family relations and family ties. And then the third one, of course, Imam said, use your house to become a means to pay hukuku shara'i. So therefore, the philosophy of wealth accumulation from Islam is that wealth is not the aim. Wealth is not a ghaya. Wealth is not a hadaf. It is means to hadaf. It is means to ghaya. So therefore, when you have something, don't become arrogant. Wealth is to make you humble. Is to make you down to earth. That's number one. Number two, what does Islamic economics say when it comes to wealth accumulation? Islamic economics. And here to understand this, I need to refer you to what you all know, to the main schools of economics we have in the world. You have the socialism or Marxism, and then you have the capitalism, and then you have the Islamic regime. Each is an economic school, and each school has its own theory and principle. Now, if you look at Marxism, they said the wealth should be state-owned, as you know. It should not be owned by any individual. That is why countries that are run by socialists and the likes, they make sure that most of the things are owned by the states. Individuals don't have to own anything. But then you have capitalism, which is running the world, mostly. Capitalists is of the opinion that, look, the world should go more to individual privatizations, and you all know about it. Now, my point is about Islam, and I want you to pay attention to this line. So that when you go out to work, you know what Islam says. What is Islamic economical approach? Islamic economical approach is marriage between socialism and capitalism. That's Islamic economical approach. What does it mean? It means Islam says the state should own and individuals should also own. But there must be a balance on how the state own and individual own. That is why Islam says the problem of the world is not lack of wealth. It's not lack of treasures. It's not lack of resources. Islam said the world is that lack of balance between the means of production and the means of distribution. That is the problem. You read Islamic economy if you have books on Islamic economics. Islam said the problem is insan himself. The problem is not lack of wealth. There is wealth, abundant wealth in the world. Islam said there is a problem between Adam with Tawazun, between what? Means of production and means of distribution. Now, this marriage which Islam says between socialism and capitalism, what is that marriage? Islam says there are two forms of ownership. We have a milkiyatun unwaniya and milkiyatun tasarruf wal istismar. Islam said we have ownership of just being a caretaker. And you have ownership of having the absolute power of usage. According to Islamic economics, whatever you make, or whatever you think you have, Islam says you are just a caretaker. You are not an absolute owner. Whatever you have, your business, yes, you sign the contract, you sell, you tie the transaction. Islam says, no, you are a caretaker. You are not the absolute owner. That is Islamic principle of economics. Why Islam says you are just a caretaker? Islam says it's simply because if today you are there, the next day you go, somebody else takes it. It's either the state take if your probate doesn't go well, or somebody inherit from you. And if the person inherit from you, you don't have any authority and power on that person anymore. Hence, Islam said you are a caretaker. So the question is, if you are given something to take care of, how do you handle it? The money you make, you are a caretaker. So now you are giving something, take care of this for me for 1 year, for 2 years, for 3 years, for 100 years. How do you handle it? Hence, Islam says, insan is not asil fi dunya. Innama huwa khalifatun fi dunya. You are not original in this world. You are just a khalifa in this world. So whatever you have it as a khalifa, as a deputy of Allah. Hence Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in Quran, in Quran 2 verse 30. Inni ja'ilun fil ardi khalifa. That a khalifa, Allah said, I put on the earth, it means insan. Meaning you are a caretaker of whatever you have. And wallahi, if really we have this mindset and this notion that we are caretakers of what we have, we will leave this dunya peacefully, we will enjoy our wealth nicely, and we'll go back to Allah peacefully, and Allah will also be happy with us. Our problem is we think we are absolute owners. And the moment you start thinking you are an absolute owner, that is where arrogance comes. That is where pride comes. That is where undermining others comes. That is why labeling people comes. But if I truly know that I'm just a caretaker, Allah has unpicked me out of billions of people of the world to take care of this world. And I know at one stage I have to gather everything and give it back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I will humble myself. Why are we caretakers? Because if you look at capitalism, said you are free to use your money. Islam said you are not free. Islam said you are not free. Because you find ayat in Quran, Allah said, وَلَا تُوتُوا سُفَهَا أَمْوَالَكُمُ الَّتِي جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. Do not give fools your money which is given to you by Allah. In other words, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala want us to use our money wisely and accordingly. In other words, Islam is trying to say extravagance is haram. Wastage is haram. But of course, in the capitalist notion, you can use it however. You can go for whatever holidays you want. Islam said, go for that holiday so long as you need it and it's not a waste. That is why you find Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala in one beautiful ayah of Quran, where Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is telling us, Quran 16 verse 112, وَضَرَبَ اللَّهُ مَثَلًا كَرِيَةً كَانَتْ آمِنَةً مُتْمَئِنَّةً يَأْتِهَا رِزْقُهَا رَغَدًا مِنْ كُلِّ بَابٍ فَكَفَرَتْ بِأَنْعُمِ اللَّهِ فَأَذَاكَهَا اللَّهُ لِبَاسَ الْجُوعِ وَالْخَوْفِ بِمَا كَانُوا يَصْنَعُونَ. الله أكبر. Allah said, I give an example of a small town. This small town, كانت آمينة مطمئنة. The town was آمينة, living in peace, and مطمئنة, she was in tranquility. Tranquil town. يَأْتِيَا رِزُقُهَا رَغَدًا مِنْ كُلِّ بَابٍ. Her sustenance was coming to her from all doors. فَكَفَرَتْ بِأَنْعُمِ اللَّهِ. When the sustenance were coming, this town did not take heed to the teachings of Allah. She went against Allah and became ungrateful to the command of Allah. What has Allah said? فَأَذَاكَهَا اللَّهُ لِبَاسَ الْجُوعِ وَالْخَوْفِ. When she went against Allah, she did not use the wealth the way Allah wanted her to use. Allah said, then we tested her with the cloth of hunger and fear. So therefore, mu'minin and mu'minat, whatever we have, we are caretakers. Look after it very well. Use it wisely. As they said in economics, make judicious use of it. Make this economic term, make judicious use of it. Don't just use money anyhow. Today you have orphans. You have people who are homeless. You have people who do not have what to eat. Don't use it anyhow. Allah is watching.
When you accumulate the wealth, refer to the teachings of Allah
subhanahu wa ta'ala. And lastly, inshallah, next week we'll continue. Time is over. Islamic humanitarian principles of wealth accumulation. First, economics. Second, philosophy. Now, humanitarian principle. Islam comes with and said, this wealth that you have accumulated has not changed you. You still human being. You still insan. And you still going to deal with insan. Hence, in the process of accumulating the wealth, Islam put forward some principles. Look at these principles and think about them. We'll dwell more on that. Number one, as a Muslim, which alhamdulillah, even non-Muslims are doing it much better. Islam says when someone buys something from you and he regrets and brings it back, take it. And yakbal an-nadim. And we have a beautiful tradition that whoever accepts what is brought back to him of his sales, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala will alleviate his suffering on the day of Qiyamah. Akala Allahu atharatahu yawm al-qiyamah, Rasulullah. So the first humanitarian principle is what? When someone buys something from you and he regrets and brings it back, as a Muslim, you don't even need law to tell you accept. Although we have in these retailers, you've got the customer, whatever, you can bring it back, isn't it? Islam says humanitarian ground, take it back. It is something that Islam put much emphasis. That's why I always mention, as you go about your life, ask for Islamic teachings on what you are doing. Islam is a holistic way of life. Don't ever think Islam is backward and we only talk about salah fasting. Islam attend to each and every facet of our lives, and you as a Muslim, you are expected to find out this particular thing that I'm doing, what are the teachings of Islam about it. Number two, Islam said an yakbal ar-rajih. What is rajih? Allahu Akbar. This is Islamic principle. When somebody comes and buys something from you, if you can add him on top of what he bought something as a gift, add. It's Islamic humanitarian principle. Oh, no. You use your energy to do something for someone. And Islam said, no, if you have the time, add more energy, which you don't take money from the person. Meaning be charitable in what you do. Hence, a lady went and bought something in Kufa. And as he was standing by, in Amir al-Mumini was standing there. She said to the seller, can you add some meat? Because this will not be enough and I don't have the money. The seller insisted no. Amir al-Mumini looked at the seller and said, please add for her. فَإِنَّ فِيهَا خَيْرٌ وَبَرَكَ. Add to her, because you adding it, there is khair and there is baraka. Third principle of Islam. Don't hide the aib of what you sell. See, today people, they want to make money. They show you, they don't show you complete. They show you halfway. When you buy, you are inside, you're like, this is not new. Or he sell you medicine which is about to expire. He show you property which he doesn't show you everything. When you sign the contract, you see. Islam says it's haram to hide the aib of what you sell. If you hide the aib what you sell, Rasulullah mentioned, Allah will expose your aib even to your family. Today you find a lot of Muslims, you go to these shops. They sell things and they hide the aib. Fourth one, Islam said when you sell as a Muslim, avoid swearing by Allah's name. Wallah, kasamti, wallah. It's not acceptable in market. Some even said, I swear by the jan of my mother, Ajib. The jan, your mother, you putting the jan into trouble. Islam said, forget ishtanibul health. Stay away from swearing. I swear by Allah. I swear this, wallah. No, you know, I will not give you a bad thing. You don't know me? We've grown up together. Islam said, forget about that during business and transaction.
That is Islamic humanitarian principle of business. And the next one, Islam said, al-ihtikar. What is ihtikar? You know you are selling this commodity. It could be food, it could be medicine, it could be cloth. But then it is very scarce in the market. And you know, if you keep it for some time, you will make a lot of money, although people are in need of it. It's haram. That's ihtikar. If yes, I'm keeping it when it is in abundance in the market, there's nothing wrong. But I know I'm keeping it and people are in need of it. I know if I stay after some time, the money will appreciate or the value will appreciate. It's haram in Islam. A Muslim cannot do that. Although business people do, even in our communities. You see, this person needs it and this thing is very scarce in the market. But you know, let him keep it after 1 year, after 6 months, it will appreciate. When people are in dire need of it, you cannot keep it as a Muslim. Although the law tells you are fine, but Islam said, no, this is, you are insane, they are human beings, they need it. And the last but not least, soum. You know what is soum? Haji Mushtaq. You see, I forgot your name because I've been long away. Haji Mushtaq, you are a businessman and I'm a businessman. And I know you are having some deal which you are trying to do. But maybe because you don't have the money which they are looking for, then I go behind you and give them more to get it. It's haram for Muslim to do that. Yani, when someone is on a deal, Islam does not allow us to go and negotiate it until the person is out of it. Islam is strong. But I know he's in this deal. He's busy. And I know the guy will not make it. Let him just add increase. Then I can make it. Islam said it's greediness and it's haram. So therefore, sometimes when I look at the way we do our businesses, I sit with some of the business people in our communities. I think we need some serious workshops on how to handle some of these things. Because it's not about just accumulating the wealth. It's about the etiquette and the principles. Therefore, we ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to forgive us our shortcomings. We ask subhanahu wa ta'ala to put barakah in our rizq and our earnings. Where we make mistakes, ya Allah, we ask you to forgive us, insha'Allah. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنا أعطيناك الكوفر فصل لربك وانحر إن شانئك هو الأبتر اللهم صل على محمد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين إنه خير ناصر ومعين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد اللهم صل وسلم على علي أمير المؤمنين وعلى الصديقة الطاهرة فاطمة الزهراء سيدة نساء العالمين اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد وعلى الحسن والحسين سيد الشباب أهل الجنة اللهم صل على محمد وعلى علي بن الحسين زين العابدين اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي والحجة بن الحسن القائم المنتظر أجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف وسهل الله مخرجا اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد اللهم إنا نرغب إليك في دولة كريمة تعز بها الإسلام وأهلا وتذل بها النفاق وأهلا وتجعلنا فيها من الدعاة إلى طاعتك والقادة إلى سبيلك وترزقنا بها كرامة الدنيا والآخرة إنك على كل شيء قدير صلوات اللهم صل على محمد وعجل فرجهم وفرجنا بهم يا كريم. In our second sermon, I first admonish myself and each and every one of you, respected mu'mineen and mu'minat, to have the taqwa or the consciousness of the teachings of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I have been told here that there is a brother who has lost two rings a few weeks ago here at the mosque. If the rings are yours, inshallah, you can kindly see Brother Mahdi or those who are in charge to give you the rings, inshallah. Also, inshallah, there is a milad of Bibi Fatima al-Zahra, salawatullahi wa salamahu alayha. Organized by the Absox on the 11th of March in Leicester, and the transport will be here available 6:30 p.m. for mu'mineen and mu'minat, inshallah, to join in the celebration of the life of the Lady of Light. And lastly, on the 2nd of March, inshallah, there is going to be a mental health workshop here at the mosque. That is next week, Friday, at night. Mu'mineen and mu'minat are expected to attend, inshallah. We ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to forgive us and grant us mercy and the shafa of Ahlul Bayt, inshallah. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Qul huwallahu ahad, Allahu samad, lam yalid wa lam yulad, wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الله أكبر الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. أشهد أن عليا ولي الله. أشهد أن عليا حجة الله.